Hey y'all, we've got Willow 2 Daily Data News coming at you, and today is February 23rd at 10:19. I don't know if you can see that or if the camera will focus on it, but anyhow, I've got an incident about my life that's been going on here in Owensboro, Kentucky. Y'all need to know the relationship, if you call it that, the torture, the tyrannical behavior of this city has had against me for more than a decade. It began, to my knowledge, in 2003. This is going to lead up to my having been recently, as of January 16th, arrested. All right, I'm totally disabled. I got hurt at work twice due to unsafe working conditions back in 81 and again in 83, whereby I am totally disabled. And due to the treatments that I received from the doctor, the so-called medical profession, with a snake crawling up the pole, I ended up with dead bone throughout my body. Two hips that need to be replaced, a right knee and a left ankle, but the right knee and the left ankle are workers' comp, even though they're not paying for my knee, they are the cause of it. And my entire spine to be rebuilt, and I have severe spinal stenosis, whereby the vertebrae are collapsing down on themselves because of their corticosteroid injections, daggone near monthly for 25 years, no one telling me it was destroying my body or the bones, and I didn't have a computer back in those days, so I had no idea. I put my trust in the medical profession, and they gave me more disabilities, okay, on top of. So, I have three eye diseases as a result of it, where I'm losing my sight, so they say. And, you know, glaucoma on top of it, too. And I have the severest form of rheumatoid arthritis. And or so says my former rheumatologist that said that out of his thousand patients, I was the worst case scenario. Okay, now that I've gotten all that said, I also want to say that I am not suicidal. I am not on any medications except for my eye drops. That's it. I weaned myself off of all the vile pharmaceutical killer drugs more than 10 years ago, and I will not have another one pass my lips. So I've been learning somewhat about the holistic things, and I haven't found anything for my eyes as of yet. So, I am a staunch, faith-filled individual, or not individual, but a woman. I believe in the Father Almighty. I've been a recipient and participant and having seen numerous miracles, there is no denying that he exists, not in my world. All right, getting on with the story. In 2003, I had filed bankruptcy due to medical expenses and something someone did to me, and that doesn't matter who. But anyway, it led me down that path, and I had gone to, you know, it was in so-called federal court, which we know none of that exists anymore in relation to the 1933 Bankruptcy Act. The federal government was dissolved. Okay, so everything out there is a prop, smoke and mirrors, and BS. But back then, you know, I didn't know that. So the so-called federal judge made my house exempt, you know, I guess because I rolled in there in my wheelchair. And I'm not wheelchair confined, folks, but to go anywhere in the world, I need my wheelchair. When I go to the store and Walmart and all that, They have to bring out their electric cart for me to get my shopping done, and then it's directly back home. Okay, and I'm so daggone tuckered out when I do that. You know, I don't even cook on those days, fix dinner, because I'm so wore out from doing it, because those carts move like a snail. So by the time I get home, I'm tired, and so I usually buy something out, you know, fast food, whatever. Oh, that went down wrong. So my coffee went down the wrong way. But, doggone it. But due to my rheumatoid arthritis, I do have inflammation in my lungs, and I do cough, and sometimes a lot. But so bear with me, okay? And I'm sorry that I do, but I can't help that. So the judge had made my home exempt in the bankruptcy, Chapter 7. So not quite a year after that bankruptcy, JPMorgan Chase had bought out or whatever, merged with the initial bank. And we know all the mortgages is fraud. It's all paid for with your signature under the SESTA-QV trust and your Social Security number, which they tap into it. So anyway, we know the banks are snakes and shysters. And the judge ended up making an exempt. They ended up finding the paperwork that they went through the previous bank and said, aha, well, she didn't pay them. We're going after them, you know. Well, I never had a contract with JPMorgan Chase. And it doesn't matter whether they merged or not. The bankruptcy thing did away with it. And so I never did pay again. I paid again a while, but I never re-signed on the note or whatever they wanted to call it and reaffirmed it or anything. So they ended up pursuing me for 13 years to try to steal my house. And the city of Owensboro and the sheriff's department helped facilitate the actions. And everybody, the county and the city tax offices, went back, because at that time, I think I'd lived here 38 years or 37 years, whatever it was, okay, from 1977, October, matter of fact, of 1977, when I purchased it, and they ended up fabricating a $400, and I believe it was $87 or $78, whatever, taxes on the house. And they never told me about it. So JPMorgan Chase, when their case against me had been dismissed for lack of prosecution in 2012, that was the last time I was ever into their court system. I went, you know, and the judge, you know, said that they was dismissing it and had already dismissed it, but the attorneys there representing them, and I was tell him the whole time, you know, anything and everything he says is hearsay. You know, you're supposed to be able to face your accuser, you know what I mean, and be able to ask them questions. Hello. So anyway, I was kept, every time he opened his mouth, I was saying, I object, and he screamed at me and said, you know, he's going to hear what he had to say. I said, okay. So anyway, I said, let it show for and on the record. And so the attorney said whatever he had to say, you know, blah, blah, with his partner in crime. And he ended up telling him that the case had been dismissed. He appreciated him showing up, though. And then he said it was dismissed without prejudice. Well, then I knew what that meant. That meant that they could come back at me at any given time in the future. So I was going to have that hanging over me. And I asked the judge point blank, why aren't you dismissing it with prejudice. And he just looked down at me and grinned like the snakes that they are. And so, sure enough, in 2013, I don't even think it was 6 months after the case had been dismissed, that they end up pursuing me again. But the thing was that I knew enough at that time about codes and statutes and all that. They had to have so-called new evidence to end up continuing. See, I was not made privy of that new evidence. And that's where they had gone behind my back, created the $487 tax bill. That's both the city and county combined. And they sent it to J.P. Morgan Chase. They paid it. And then one day I get a letter in the mail from them saying that they were going to foreclose on me if I didn't pay them back. And they paid it on my behalf. Well, first off, I didn't ask them to pay it on my behalf. Second off, they had paid that back in the end of 2012 before their case had been dismissed and or just at the beginning of them pursuing me again in 2013. Well, they forgot one critical little point. Because of my being disabled, Kentucky exempts people with disabilities, at least 100% disability, I don't know about those that aren't, from paying taxes. So, but they forgot about that, so they kind of hung themselves. So they paid the daggone tax bill. So I ended up getting a letter telling me they were going to do that. And I'm thinking, doesn't one hand know what the other hand's doing? You're already in a foreclosure with me. So see, they're letting this letter out and threatening to foreclose. So I sat there and laughed at it. And then I called down there to tax offices. I said, excuse me. I said, where did this $487 tax bill come from? I said, I've never heard about it. And J.P. Morgan sent me a letter. And she said, well, don't you still live at your address? I said, yes, I most certainly do. And or at my domicile. And I said, yes, I do. She said, then you got the bill. I said, hold up, lady. I said, do you have a bona fide accusatory instrument by which you can make that statement as a fact? She says, huh? I said, do you have my John Henry verifying that I received said bill? She says, no. I said, well, this can go one of two ways. Either I said, I'm pursuing them for their 13 years of BS. I said, I'd be glad to add your name and your clerk's name to this tort that I'm filing in federal court. And I said, or you can take the other route and exonerate the bill. She said, I'll have to call you tomorrow. So she did. She called the next day. She said, it's been exonerated. I said, great. She said, I'm going to send you the money back. I said, hold up. I don't want it. Send it back to the shysters that ended up paying it for the fact of trying to steal my house again. And then attach a note and tell them to shove it where the sun don't shine. And she said, I can't. Now, I knew that she couldn't send it back to them, or at least I felt that way until here I am asking her. And she said, I can't. And I said, why is that? She said, because you are the title deed holder. You're the deed holder. And I said, yep, you bet your patootie I am. I said, they've never been on my lien or deed or title. Never. And so she ended up sending me that money. And I extracted enough to send the remainder of it back, but I took out enough just to mail it FedEx back to them with the note that I asked her to attach to it. Now, this camera is going to cut off at 27 minutes, so this will be a two-parter or three-parter. This incident with me and the city has gone on for a long time, okay? City and county. So, anyway, I sent them that back, minus the amount for the FedEx. So this has been an ongoing thing between me, and I started getting stalked back then, and people hanging out over at the Ramada Inn, which is directly behind my house, and the Yellow Rose, which is a closed-down bar, Devil's Dens, both of them. So, fast forward to about a year, year and a half ago, the man and his wife cross the street at a 45 degree angle ended up having a truck that every time they fired it up, it sounded like a daggone bomb going off, you know? And these walls in these cheap old prefab homes they slap together does not have insulation in the walls, okay? Their terminology for insulation is some tar paper slapped on the outside of the walls and then put whatever, you know, the vinyl or the shingles, you know, his house at one time had shingles on it and now it's got vinyl on it. So they end up waking me up all the time. I have to sleep in my living room, you all, because I have to use this medical equipment, the lift chair, that helps to stand me up and lays me down. I sleep in it. I live in it, okay, because workers' comp's not doing their daggone, you know, care of me that they're supposed to do and provide me things for me to be able to live my life the best that I can being disabled. So we won't get off on a workers' comp. That's another issue. But I'm in a chair, and that's all I've showed it in the past in my videos, and my wheelchair parked at the front door, and I can't use it because I don't have any way to haul it. It's a 410-pound electric wheelchair. And so, anyhow, they, where was I? Like you're going to be able to answer me. So anyway, they ended up, hold up. They, the guy across the street, they were keeping me awake all the time. So I started reporting to the police, station about the noise violations. And they gave him a ticket when they fired it up in the driveway, but they're supposed to, according to city ordinance, give them a ticket every time they fired it up. So, I mean, we're talking about somebody not doing it just during the day. They do it late at night. I mean, it was, they go and come like you would not believe. So they ended up disturbing my peace and my quiet for close to 2 years. This was affecting my health, which kicked off my rheumatoid arthritis because I'm supposed to rest when I rest. And I couldn't get sleep during the day or at night. It didn't matter. And I have a sound machine that I have sitting parked at my head when I lay back in this chair to go to sleep at night. But it doesn't do for that thing, his truck. And he was told how to fix it. I mean, you know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure, okay, you can take some heavy-duty aluminum foil, make several layers over it, put a daggone clamp over it, or put some wire over it, twist the daggone thing, you're done. Hello? You don't have the hole there, you know what I mean? So, but he didn't do any of that, you know. And so I called police every time he woke me up, which was quite often. And I mean, I'm sure I made hundreds of calls over a long period of months, hundreds. And but they wouldn't do it. And I had the actual assistant chief of police, whatever he's called, end up telling me he wasn't going to give him any more tickets. Well, that's not what your city ordinance says. It's for each incident. But anyway, yeah, and that's been uploaded on YouTube. So this went on, and it was affecting my health drastically. So then the next-door neighbor, that little guy over there, I'll try to keep from saying names and what I'd like to say about him. But anyway, he ended up pulled in when I called the neighbor, the old lady that lived there. She just recently passed away. But she ended up, she had company in there like Grand Central Station. And I called her up one day. We used to be really good neighbors. I mean, really good neighbors. I mean, they used to swim in my pool. I taught her granddaughter how to swim. I used to, you know, when I had a riding lawnmower, I have done their yard when they were in the hospital or whatever. I mean, this was decades back, you know, when I was able to do that stuff. I can't even do my own yard now and haven't for years. But she, I called her up and I asked her if she could please have her company stop beeping their horn when they arrive, when they leave, when they lock their doors, and everything's beeping all the daggone time, slamming doors. Because her driveway is only 10 foot from my wall to my home. And, you know, it's disturbing my peace. And so she retaliated because of my calling, and I nicely said it to her the first time. And she ended up telling her grandson to park between the houses where the truck's firing up, and sitting by my window air conditioner unit woke me up every morning at 7:05, and he'd leave and let that daggone motor run for 20 minutes. Winter or summer, it made no daggone difference. So, between him and them across the street, I was getting no sleep. So, and it just kept compounding and compounding, and I kept getting madder and madder and sicker and sicker, and couldn't get anybody to do a daggone thing in this city or county. Sheriff's department, cops, nobody. All right, because I won in my case with the house, you see, and that ticked them off that they couldn't put me on a street. So they ended up filing. Well, wait a minute, I'm getting ahead of myself. He ends up one night out of desperation. I decided to park my truck in my yard, and I made daggone sure it was in my yard, even though her 7 inches, 10 inches of her property goes into mine in the grass. I made daggone sure I was on my property, and I was close to my house. And so her grandson comes in, who was living there and still is, and ended up calling the cops, saying that I was infringing on her property rights. Now, she wasn't the one that called. He had no right to call. And since how that would have been a civil matter, if I believed in all that crap with the court now, then that was for us to battle it out, not the cops to get involved. So the cops ended up banging on my front door. First, it was him telling me to move my truck. And then you know what kind of language I use with that, without me repeating myself. So then another knock came at the door, and I said, who, you know, blah, 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 is it? And they said, the cops. I said, yeah, well, you're trespassing. Get off my property, just like I told him. And the sign sitting on the door has been for a long time. So anyhow, they said, well, if you're not going to move, you're not going to move it. They kept asking. I said, no, I'm not. I said, it's on my property. Well, so the cops take it into their hand of calling the wrecker service. The wrecker service is McCarty Tow and Auto Repair, which used to be my mechanics. So they ended up coming, and they drug my truck off of my property to at a 45 degree angle and hoisted up on a flatbed truck and drove off. That's Grand Theft Auto, people. Grand Theft Auto. It was on my daggone property. And I proved that later on that day. That was at 12 midnight. It was so freaking important for them to do this to me. But it's retaliation from the city and the county to me. Okay, and this little pipsqueak next door. So, fast forward to, they charged me with phone call harassment to the police department. And what was that other one? Oh, disorderly conduct. Because as they're stealing my truck, I've got my video camera at the front door on a 4-inch open door, and I'm cussing them out, telling them they're traitors and treasonous and oath breakers and, you know, tyrants, etc. What all I said, that's up online too. And so, and I was using the F word several times and screaming a lot because they were stealing my automobile. So, anyhow, this one cop said, say it one more time, as he was walking away. And I said it one more time. He asked, I complied, I did it. So I ended up saying, F you. And he spun around and said, I'm going to charge you with disorderly conduct. I said, really? I'm in my house. Okay? So then, you know, fast forward from that to now. Now, I mean, I know I'm leaving out some parts, but, you know, some detail, not a whole lot. But here we are now, what happened on January 16th. I locked my keys into my automobile when I was at a sandwich shop. This was one of the days that I was out, so I got me something to eat. And I locked the daggone keys in it, and along with my phone. I had my little purse change thing, but that was it. Well, one of the patrons of that establishment called AAA. Well, who shows up? None other than McCarty Towing. Again, I'm sorry. But when he's writing out the ticket after he opened the door, he goes back into the truck and sees there's no license plate on it. And, you know, he ended up saying, no plate. He came back to the door. He said, no plate. I said, no, I don't have to have one. And so he ends up calling the sheriff's department and the police department to tell them and give them a heads up. Now, how do I know that? Because when at 6:12, so they say, I'm not verifying that, but at 6:12 p.m. on their